Thank you very much, Carlo, for your very nice words and for arranging this talk. This talk is associated to a book which I've just written.
Yes,
I've got some flyers here, and actually should arrive soon in the United States. And also, as often happens with books, this is the outcome of a rather long itinerary, which ended up, fortunately, with a book when I found a young and energetic author, which started to be an intern at National Science Council, and then I followed a master dissertation, then taken all together my notes. She did an excellent work with Alice, and so. That's the story. When does the story ends? It starts. The story is a story that you know very well, the story of Nuremberg. The story of Nuremberg, which in Tokyo, and which ended far too early, ended with the Cold War, leaving the promise as it was. You know, and since then, after 1946, thank you very much, much appreciated. We didn't have any additional international tribunals in the world. Then suddenly, there was the end of the Cold War, and the new season of tribunals started to be active with different legal tools. And actually, I was one of the activists which led to that. At the time, I was living in Cambridge, United Kingdom. One of my colleagues was James Crawford, which was the ending draft of the International Criminal Court first draft, the statute of the first draft. At the time, I was traveling between Cambridge and Rome, and Rome, there were every 6 months a new foreign affairs minister, and I managed to interact with several of them, and as you know, Italy was one of the countries, together with Canada and Germany, which took the lead, and in 1998, the Treaty of the International Criminal Court was signed in Rome. And actually, you know, was a feast, a celebration. Quite a lot of activists were there, and you know, we were happy to celebrate with the delegations of developing countries, which were asked for, were asking advice, were asking information, and so on. So somehow it was very much a hope which was fulfilled. It was not only the only case, there were other cases which were really important, you know. Before that, there were the two ad hoc tribunals for the former Yugoslavia, our neighboring country, where there was a vicious, irrational civil war, which Europe did not manage to stop. Something as a spin-off of that, the tribunal in Rwanda, much less at the core of the European interest, and then quite a lot of other ventures which happened to be there, including quite a few national courts. We started to be more daring by using the old category of universal jurisdiction, and therefore they started to do something and to, you know, impeach or indict, whatever it is, authors of international crimes in other countries, even when they did not have a specific mandate to do that. So 25 years passed. Where are we now? Can we be happy about that? What can we do? You know? And this is the purpose of the book. The book is devoted to provide an overview about the hopes which over these 25 years have been partially been realized, but still are there, because as you know, international crimes are everywhere. We continue to have an enormous amount of international crimes. International trials are just a few, very, very few. So we started to think about the framework, which can understand why at a certain point there are some trials, and in many of the locations there are no trials. And this framework is very, very simple, namely, on a certain level, there is an intergovernmental consensus. So governments decide they have to do something. In many cases, they have to do something when they are not prepared to do more demanding, expensive, and risky activities. That's the typical case of Rwanda. No peacekeepers were sent by the United Nations, but as soon as the genocide was finished, they instituted an international tribunal. Something similar can be said also for the former Yugoslavia. You know, they were not daring to do something more energetic, even because it was very clear what could have been done, then they instituted the tribunal, and so on. In other cases, the international consensus is more complicated. It requires to create institutions, such as the International Criminal Court, to sign treaties, it's a long, long process, and so on. In other cases, you have got an autonomous procedure which is not predicted, and that may come from judges that decide to do something, especially when they apply the case of universal jurisdiction in the countries where you can do that. This happened in the past. For example, in the Cold War period, the only judges which were actually able to use universal jurisdiction were American judges, because they were somehow protected by their own country. You know, if you were a country in a weaker country, you could not really have the political muscles to do that. And sometimes also, I wouldn't deny that, social and political activism is also very important in demanding and obtaining that something needs to be done, and therefore, you know, you try to do something in this process. Now, the literature on these issues is pretty enormous by international scholars, by lawyers, and so on. But we are focused on something which is slightly different, namely not to focus on the institutions. And therefore, you know, if you look, for example, at the commentaries on the International Criminal Court Treaty and Statute, it's an enormous literature. The same applies for the ad hoc tribunals of the former Yugoslavia and Rwanda, and so on. Often, this literature misses the point, because it's not enough to have a tribunal, to have an active tribunal. Some of these tribunals can be empty boxes, you know, or might focus, as happening, I will tell something about that later, on issues which are very minor and are not the principal actions for which we think an international criminal justice is actually needed, you know. So we have decided to concentrate on trials, and these trials are the trials against heads of states. Why? Because there is a dangerous tendency to look at minor trials committed by, for example, soldiers, which of course are committed crimes, you know, and that's bad, of course, they are crimes. I'm not denying that. But often you try the soldier and not the head of the government, which has sent the soldier to do these crimes, you know. And therefore, at the end, you have got very much the impression that you create a net which is somehow good to capture some mice, only a few mice, but can do anything against the tigers, you know. And that, of course, is not what we wanted. We wanted something different, you know. So the four cases we're taking into account are Augusto Pinochet, a new case under universal jurisdiction, Saddam Hussein, which is a national tribunal, but of course created by the American occupation force. Without American occupation force, as we documented in the book, it would have been impossible to have this tribunal. The two cases of Milosevic and Karadzic in the former Yugoslavia, both of them somehow heads of states, even Karadzic pretended to be head of states. And the last case is Omar al-Bashir. The cases were also selected because they apply to four different legal instruments. The first one is universal jurisdiction. The second one is a national tribunal instituted by occupation force. The third are two trials within an ad hoc tribunal. And the fourth was the International Criminal Court, the permanent institution, has tried to do with al-Bashir with almost no political outcome. So, it's a bit, and with each of these cases, you know, we find something which has happened, right or not. Other cases could have been studied, and there are also some good studies for them. One is, of course, Charles Taylor, which is now serving his 50 years sentence, I think, in the Kingdom. Issei Habre of Chad and other cases. The last one is Kenyatta in Kenya, which, as you know, there was an investigation opened by the International Criminal Court. Then when the International Criminal Court realized it was too complicated politically, then they left the case. They left the case. The case open. All in all, you know, not so many cases. And as I to repeat, the cases are much less than the international crimes. Let's start with the case of Pinochet. Pinochet was in London, was not any longer particularly powerful, but still was influential. After 10 years after he lost the referendum, he was in the United Kingdom to negotiate for some arms deal. And out of the blue, I repeat, out of the blue, a Spanish judge, Garzón, decided that he had to be incriminated for disappearance of some persons in Chile during his regime. Not all of them, because there was a lot of amnesties, but still, I mean, there were a window of opportunity, and according to the window of opportunity, Spain required that he should have been executed in Spain and to have a trial. In London, we started to have activists from Chile, which took the opportunity to ask for his arrest. Not only them, there were also other activists which supported the Pinochet. We have not to forget that often these dictatorships and also the dictators have got to not only people who like them at the bar, but you know, they're still supporters, you know? And the juridical discussion in the United Kingdom was particularly long. At the time, the Supreme Court of the United Kingdom was a special committee of the House of Lords, and they had to discuss several cases if he should have been granted immunity under the fact that he was a head of state or not. So that was the basic important discussion. We go back to Hans Kelsen, you know. If you are head of state, are you immune from personal responsibility for international crimes or not, you know? And that was the issue debated by this committee of the House of Lords. They were not particularly brave to do anything about that. Margaret Thatcher, which at the time was not any longer in power, went to see Pinochet and to give him her personal support, you know, and still, you know, the situation was long, tedious. At the end of the day, the United Kingdom's lords decided to wash their hands by saying that it was too old and not any longer able to start a trial. He went back to Chile, but that was not the end of the story, because the international challenge started to make internal judges daring much more than they had until this point. So the immunity was not any longer granted internally. For example, Pinochet, before leaving power, was very good in order to create quite a lot of a safety network of amnesties and so on for him and for the perpetrators of crimes within Chile. And one of the judges made a very important argument. He said, yes, it's okay. The amnesty is there. But before we grant the amnesty, we need to know what the crime is, who has committed it, and against whom. So we need, first of all, transparency on that. Then we can discuss this, we can grant amnesty. But we need to know, you know. And that's created a long internal legal warriors. Many other perpetrators of crimes were arrested, some of them which were not quite into the amnesties were brought to justice, and politically it had a major change in Chile to rethink about the past and to find something about the past. Pinochet died, he never entered into a courtroom, but still the indictment by Judge Garzón had a major impact in rewriting the history of the Chile dictatorship. I mean, if we look at the case of Saddam Hussein, the case of Saddam Hussein, of course, is very, very different, you know. First of all, I've got these cards. Actually, my daughter has stolen them, but I've still got them somewhere. You could buy them on the internet. These cards were distributed to all American soldiers invading Iraq. And they were the cards of 52 major perpetrators of the regime. And, you know, there was this sinister, I repeat, sinister combination of a game, actually. Even the jacket of the book is somehow inspired to the idea. This is a sinister combination of an illegal occupation married with the idea to bring to justice criminals, but with a game, you know? At the end, the game was quite successful because all the 52 persons, why 52? Because the cards are 52. Why not 53? Why not 51? You know? Why not 100? You know? Still, you know? All of them were somehow taken, killed. For example, the two children of Saddam Hussein were killed and so on. And at the end, there was a trial which was very much followed, a trial which three of the defense lawyers of Saddam Hussein were killed, you know, so basically there was no defense, not effective defense, you know, because one judge was also killed. Every time there was a broadcast, the trial was broadcast in the country, there was sectarian violence in which many people got killed, and that was a masterpiece of political incompetence. No. Saddam Hussein is, of course, was possibly the single worst political criminal of the second half of the 19th century. You know, he ended up as a martyr. You know, and that, of course, raises some fundamental issues. Some fundamental issues which might see: Do you really need a trial? Sometimes, you know, you might think that it's better to do it quick and dirty, as it was done, for example, with Bin Laden, you know, as it was done with Gaddafi, not by the Americans, but still, you know, as it was done with Saddam Hussein children, you know, quick and dirty. And therefore, you go to summary executions, what Churchill advocated instead of Nuremberg, you know, what also Stalin advocated instead of Nuremberg, and then you do not have any longer a trial which somehow should be with, you know, whatever a trial is an outcome of the liberal ideology which you grant to defend some rights, and in which there is an open discussion between two sides, which at least in front of the courts are considered to be equal. Is that, if you don't manage to do that, of course, you might really think if you need or not a trial. But anyhow, we can go on with the cases. I mean, if some of you read the book, you will find the two cases. But of course, the issue that emerged is always the same, is that witness justice, first of all, how is selected and how is efficient. I mean, witness justice, I would say here there is a small difference, you know. It's not as much a witness justice as it was in Nuremberg and in Tokyo. For example, the case of Pinochet, it was not put down by law by the witness. Judge Garcon, Spain, or even the United Kingdom didn't have any personal interest, you know. It was just a need to go back to the past. Of course, Pinochet was not any longer powerful, or at least his power was very, very small, just the power to buy some weapons in the United Kingdom, not any longer the head of state. But, I mean, we cannot frame such a case in the typical case of women's justice. Likewise, in the case of al-Bashir, something similar can be said in the case of others, which are not taken into account in the book, for example, Charles Taylor, and so on. If we look at what has happened in the trial of the former Yugoslavia, I think we need to make a difference. Because Milosevic was very much witness justice. Milosevic opposed to NATO in 1999. He was an enemy of NATO. He didn't accept the compromise. I mean, he was marginally involved in some crimes. But if you look carefully, as we try to do, the history of the trial, you really find out that, first of all, he was indicted for what happened in Kosovo in 1999. Only later, he was indicted for what has happened in Bosnia in 1994. And therefore, you know, if there was not a winning justice, he should have been indicted by the tribunal much earlier, when Karadzic was indicted. Because Karadzic was indicted in 1995, just together with Mladic, just after the Srebrenica slaughter, you know. And therefore, there is a fundamental difference between the two things, you know. In the case of Milosevic, the idea that it was winner's justice is quite relevant. In the case of Karadzic, not any longer. You know, it went to justice much later, and so on, and the situation would be different. Of course, it's very selective, very, very selective, and there are an enormous amount of the international crimes which are not taken into court, and they're still going on. Today, what we see in Syria, for example, and there's no way in which the Security Council could defer to the at the International Criminal Court for the crimes which are every day committed in this country, and so on. Efficient is very difficult. I mean, if we compare efficiency with any other criminal tribunal, we should definitely say that they are not efficient. The International Criminal Court has about 900 employees. It has a budget of 1,440,000,000 euros a year. So it's a big institution, you know. And if you look at the trials which are actually occurring, there are just a few. I think they have managed to close not more than 8 trials in about more than 16 years of activity, you know. And even some of these trials, now the agenda is to go in the totally different way that we in 1990s wanted. For example, they are starting to charge people who committed the crimes against historical and cultural heritages. You know, some of these fundamentalists who destroy monuments in Timbuktu. Fine, I mean, nothing against that. But this is not the principal purpose of the International Criminal Court. The International Criminal Court should be to target the big crime criminals, not the small ones. And that, I think, is something which needs to be addressed. Can we do something? Well, yes, many things can be done. For example, the machinery can be strengthened. Our friends of the Coalition for the International Criminal Court try to assess the curriculum of the judge candidates, which should be voted by the Assembly of States. At least in order to get somebody which is first of all competent, second somebody which is also brave, you know. And even if there is a certain amount of negotiation with, I mean, people brave like Judge Garzón, for example, perhaps even like Carla Del Ponte, you know, which was the chief prosecutor of the tribunal for ex-Yugoslavia, she started to investigate on the NATO bombing in Kosovo, where some crimes were committed, impoverished uranium, cluster bombs, and so on. So war crimes were committed there, and for these there was a competence of the tribunal. NATO has never responded, and that was the end of the story, you know. But still, you know, that's one of the things. The second thing is that sometimes civil society can also open up important cases. I will make you an example. Britain is part of the International Criminal Court from the beginning. It was one of the European countries which, not as much as Italy or Germany or Canada, but still was part of the European attempt to create the new institution. And British soldiers in Iraq committed war crimes. Also because, in my own impression, it's very difficult to fight a war without committing war crimes, you know? I mean, it's... And the first investigation carried out by Moreno Campo back in Bunche in 2005, found there was no systematic evidence that the war crimes were committed. And that was the end of the story. Some international non-governmental organizations, lawyers and so on, started to collect evidence and presented a rather important amount of evidence to the new prosecutor. And the prosecutor said, but here seems to be something systematic. And then the case is still open. Again, it's quite sad story. Why? Because as usual, some soldiers might be indicted for war crimes, but Tony Blair cannot be indicted for a crime of war. You know, it's because the reason is technical, because the crime of aggression until the next 17th of July is not yet part of what the International Criminal Court can investigate on, you know, and therefore it's not possible to incriminate Tony Blair for aggression. It will be now in for the future, you know. But still, you see that the double side, that sometimes civil society can find something in order to activate. But the story, I mean, that's, I mean, you know, the story of the book, which is also to try to go beyond all the standard stuff. And for example, you know, often we need to go beyond what the formal structure can be done. Take the case of Rwanda. In Rwanda, there's a tribunal. The tribunal has indicted less than 100 people. 66, I think, were convicted. The others not, and so on. Out of a process which, of course, a genocide of 800 people killed in 100 days cannot be committed by 100 people. You know? It's a much wider process. What do you do? Do you jail an entire country? Or do you jail half of the country? You know, it's very difficult. They tried with reconciliation and going back to some ancient African tradition, the so-called Gakaka courts. And they managed to institute 12,000 local courts like that in which people started to discuss in each village who committed some crimes against whom, and which the penalties were of course less severe, but was somehow better in terms of achieving reconciliation. Much better in terms of achieving reconciliation or even justice than anything else. That's, I mean, very much the tradition opened by Mandela and by Desmond Tutu in South Africa with the Reconciliation Commission, which, you know, that's the moment in which Desmond Tutu delivers to Mandela the report, thick report of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, which somehow was much too more successful, and then something which I think is quite important to tell. Often we are criticized because they said all the idea of international tribunals typical liberal Western approach. Yes, it is. But there are also some important contributions such as truth and reconciliation which do not belong to the liberal Western tradition, and I think that we will much need to incorporate. I mean, in other cases, it's very difficult. Take the case of Yugoslavia. Yugoslavia, I mean, there's no possibility to have any of this reconciliation. All the attempts have been carried out within each community. The Bosnians, the Serbians, the Croats, and this has led to reinforce the hostility against the other communities. All of them perceive themselves to be victims, and none of them perceive to be a criminal, you know? And the case of Yugoslavia is a terrible case. I don't know if you've seen this gentleman, Slobodan Praptik. He was for several weeks one of the most widely seen video
on YouTube,
everywhere, New York Times, Le Monde, The Guardian. He killed himself in front of the court, you know. And that's a typical case, the Raskolnikov of our times, the one which Daphne Konyai is the guilty. He was condemned for war crimes, war crimes committed in Mostar. He was a peculiar man, was an engineer. He married a Muslim woman, so he came from a mixed marriage. I mean, we know that marriage sometimes can be intense, but you know, at least you know, you had the impression that within, he was not racist, at least, you know. He was also a film director, an actor. He had a company of an acting company in Zagreb and so on. With the war, he started to have his own paramilitary company. And the members of the paramilitary company were actors, musicians, you know? I mean, and so on. He was condemned for war crimes in Mostar for 20 years. He served already 13, 14 years. He was condemned against in the appeal. He did not accept the sentence, you know? And they said, I'm not a war criminal, and I will show you by getting this drink with this toast, you know?
How did he get the drink in the court?
That's an investigation. We don't know.
And was he Croat?
Croat, yes. It was Croat. I mean, there is an ongoing investigation. But you know, I mean, even in New York City, Michele Sinduna managed to get the same drink, you know. I don't know if you know, an Italian mafia leader, which was jailed here in New York, and apparently, there are some drinks which can be brought to prison, so despite all the controls that you do, you know. And the basic story is that, you know, often war crimes are committed by so many people that there are only one side, that all of them are victims. The other things on which I'm very familiar and very interested is the opinion tribunals. Often when the official tribunals do not work, the civil society can really arrange to have their own tribunals. Bernard Russell did it in 1966 together with Jean-Paul Sartre and Jobas and Simone de Beauvoir and others against the war crimes in Vietnam, you know. This tradition has continued. Many other, for example, there was a rather important tribunal for the Iraq war in Turkey, which received not so much attention, but still was quite, influential. Others can be instituted, and these civil society tribunals, of course, have no legal power, no possibility to enforce a sentence, but can provide a lot of information, which can, first of all, can even be given to the courts, to the official courts. Second, can have an impact on the public opinion, you know? And, you know, let me say, when I started to be interested, that was when in Rome, Lelio Basso, the only survivor of the ancient tribunal for crimes in Vietnam, launched the second one against torture in Latin America. And that's the ruling he read in Teatro Argentina, in magnificent theater in Rome, which for the occasion was used for this purpose. It's not unusual. Many theaters have been used for these tribunals. For example, Eichmann was tried in a room which was originally a theater, organized for the event specifically for this purpose. The Nuremberg room itself was very well built in order to have a wonderful set for press, for photographers, for cameramen, and so on. And at the time I was in high school, actually, yes, at the very beginning of high school, I accompanied a person which I met at the time, which was a Brazilian man which was tortured in 1971. And so it was one of the witnesses in which he reported the story. It was a vicious story because he was tortured in front of his wife, and his wife was pregnant, I can imagine. And now later it's better in Brazil, he's professor now, retired professor of international relations. His child is in Rome and he's become a psychologist specializing in the couple therapy, can you imagine? Mm-hmm. But that gives you the idea of, that's when I originally I started to think about all these issues. Perhaps the only important story was when I read Thomas Mann, Dr. Faustus. And in Thomas Mann, Serenus Diet Bloom reports an event of 1946 And the event was the event of General Patton. General Patton was a peculiar general. He lost troubles twice an hour. And he was the one who freed Birkbeck. And he wrote to us in hour and said, send us many cameramen and reporters to document all this. You know, we have seen this vicious camp and so on. And in between these reporters, there were the best of Hollywood, Billy Wilder was there, and photographers and so on. And actually, some photos were published the week after on Life, which at the time was the most widely diffused American magazines, of course, you know, where they were documenting, I mean, Life documented also in Hiroshima, to be honest. Not only the crimes committed by the enemies, but also the crimes committed by the Americans. General Patton did something more, and since the Birkbeck is about 9 miles away from Wagner, you know, Wagner, the city of Goethe, the city of Schiller, the very cradle of German Enlightenment and Romanticism, he took a number of these people and they said, now you walk. And you walk to Birkbeck, and you really see the film of this event in which all these people, we are speaking about April 1945, the war was still on, Hitler was still alive, you know, was still, I mean, at the very end of the Second World War, but still, the war was still going on. And all these Germans, you know, you can really see that they were walking almost happy in the woods. For them, the war was over, there was not any longer the danger of bombing, you know, it was a new page. And then they said they had to see, and often guided by the members of the concentration camps, the survivors, you know, guided there, showing what was happening there. Which tells you that sometimes, you know, there is not only a problem of indicting a dictator, but to create a much wider awareness of the crime of war and war crimes. And this, I think, is still the lesson that we need today. Thank you very much.
What was the reason you gave for why the International Criminal Court can't pursue charges of war crimes against Tony Blair? Is it not enough time has passed or something? I didn't get that.
The statute of the International Criminal Court, the statute of the International Criminal Court has four international crimes, you know? And these are war crimes, aggression, genocide, and crimes against humanity, you know? Of these four crimes, one of them was postponed. And only in the conference which was held in 2012, the state parties eventually agreed to start to give mandate to the court to investigate and to act also for the crime aggression. And this will be in 17 July 2018, namely 20 years after the original signing of the Treaty of Rome. So basically, if Blair would have been committed the crime of genocide, or crimes against humanity, or war crimes, he could be indicted. But that, of course, the crime of aggression is what the head of the state should be afraid of, you know? And therefore, you know, everything was postponed as much as possible.
Thanks.
But by the way, sorry, I mean, just to technically speaking, the boring part is of course the technical, but I mean, there were attempts to think that, for example, if the International Criminal Court should act also against terrorism, you know? But then the general agreement is that when you've got the terrorism, intergovernmental cooperation is more effective, and therefore governments should cooperate among themselves and use the national courts, you know? And therefore there is no need to go to the International Criminal Court. And therefore terrorist crimes were, I think, wisely excluded from the original mandate of the ICC.
Thank you. Yeah, I was going to actually ask on that point if you thought that maybe the ICC should expand from only the four crimes they're covering to maybe include, so you brought up terrorism, but also ecocide maybe, or economic crimes, or just, do you think there should be any discussion of broadening, or should it stay within the very focused, I guess, traditional human rights conception?
Thank you for the question. Yes, there are a lot of crimes, of course, which are not. I think it's better to, first of all, the International Criminal Court statute cannot change, because it will require the agreement of about 80% of the member states. So we got that, we can enlarge the mandate towards a more daring interpretation, but technically speaking, it's very unlikely that it's going to change. That's the first story. Second, the International Criminal Court should focus on something which national courts are not able to do. In many cases, all these crimes are very important, but somehow we can assume that the cooperation among national courts will be more effective in order to obtain the outcome, you know? And therefore, if we enlarge too much the mandate of the International Criminal Court, I think it's going to block everything. So I think the International Criminal Court was originally designed to trial these crimes which states themselves did not have the willingness to investigate or to punish, you know. Already now there is, as I said, you know, if you look at the last mandate of the Office of the Prosecutor, they are going very much into issues such as destruction of historical heritage and so on. It's not bad, but why do they do that? Because they're to justify their activity, their salaries, and they cannot go against the states. And therefore, you know, the more they will be able to do something which is not conflicting with the states, the happier they are. But that's, I don't think, at least personally, this is not the reason why we want the International Criminal Court.
Yeah, so just to follow up, why are they able to go after the monuments? Is it because it's like cultural destruction and that counts as genocide or something like that?
Yeah, not genocide, I consider crimes against humanity.
Okay.
Technically, the category of crimes against humanity was somehow at the beginning a residual category, you know? Everything that you cannot cannot use all the categories, you know? Which is fine, it had a very useful purpose historically. And now they are enlarging it without having to rewrite or to modify the statute, which would be very difficult to do.
I found it interesting when you said that Pinochet was actually, although he was investigated by ICC, that actually his big problem was within the state of Chile when he returned. Is there other instances where in the international arena, if it's powerless or ineffective, that the state ends up acting based on its suggestion or its initiation of a charge?
Good question. It doesn't seem to me that there are other obvious cases. Other obvious cases actually are a bit dangerous, because we can think about the famous Noriega, Ananas Face, I think it was called Ananas Face, you know, which was put down by law, jailed when it was killed by the United States, and went to be jailed in France and so on. But it's a total different case. Other cases, I don't really think so. And Pinochet originally, of course, was tried by, the attempt was by a national court, you know. Now, universal jurisdiction was a very tricky issue because for example, Belgium in 1994 had a very, very extensive interpretation of universal jurisdiction. And that was because Rwanda was a former colony of Belgium. Belgium felt humiliated for what has happened without having the possibility to act. And therefore, the parliament, on the emotional moment, decided we will use universal jurisdiction against everybody. There were a few cases in which this happened and they managed to indict people responsible or associated to genocide in Rwanda. But then, since the norms were quite wide, and basically every bench and judge could trial anybody, you know, they started to indict NATO officials, head of states, Sharon, Arafat, and so on. And especially when they started to touch NATO, NATO said, either you change the legislation or we take the headquarters and we move out from Brussels, you know? And the threat was very effective, and they changed the rule, and therefore the universal jurisdiction in Belgium is now much more restricted. Of course, when you trial somebody which is not particularly powerful, nobody will complain. I will take an example also in order to provide a bit of gender equality. I mean, it's a book, we don't use neutral gender terms for the very simple reason that all people in Dictator are men. I mean, there are no international crimes committed by women, or at least they do not appear to be in the book. Only four Rwandan nuns have been indicted and condemned, according to universal jurisdiction, in a Finnish court. You know? But still, I repeat, they are not, you know, they are not the most important components of the genocide.
Three very quick questions. The first two are point of information. Does the Security Council need to authorize or initiate the process? I mean, what? I mean, how does the process start at the International Criminal Court? Mm-hmm. That's number one.
Yeah, of course.
Or shall I?
No, that's okay. This is very simple. Is one of the options according to which the Security Council could investigate. In other words, one is the attention of the prosecutor. So the prosecutor can act directly, but can act only within the 123 member states of the International Criminal Court. And China, Russia, the United States, India, and other 56 states are not members of Iraq, are not members of the International Criminal Court. So in this case, the prosecutor cannot act directly, you know? He could act if the Security Council provides a mandate. What's the logic? The Security Council has the option to institute specific ad hoc tribunals, as it did with Rwanda and ex-Yugoslavia, and his team, or with the team in Paraguay in some cases, but the state party said, if there is a general consensus within the Security Council, why do we need to create another ad hoc court? We can ask the Security Council to give the mandate to the International Criminal Court. That's the second possibility. The third possibility, which is also tricky, is when a state defers itself crimes committed in its territory. And this was a modality which was often used by African states fighting against the rebels. And therefore, you know, if the rebels were committed, and so when the International Criminal Court was investigating on the crimes committed by the rebels, all African governments were happy about that. When the International Criminal Court has started to indict a head of state, such as al-Bashir and later Kenyatta, the African Union said, no, that is a colonialism, a new form of colonialism. You know, you, the white man, is putting on trial the black man, which, I mean, somehow is even true, but not because, it, you know, to be outspoken, you know. I haven't found a single judicial error in all the proceedings I've studied. All the people which have been at the bar, indicted, incriminated, condemned, all of them have committed egregious crimes. Okay? We can, of course, discuss if this has been selected, and therefore, and that's what I definitely agree, has been a selected judge. But you know, I mean, I personally, I don't have any sympathy with any of the people which have been indicted by all the international criminal justice devices.
Except Milosevic, of course.
You know, that's perhaps, you know, Milosevic is a bit, at least because Milosevic was very witty. Pinochet was extremely witty. If you listen at the records of his conversations and so on, you often, everybody was breaking in love into the courtroom, you know, which was the story, you know, because he was speaking in English and so on. Milosevic was also a criminal, but here we go, I mean, a much general issue. Top politicians, as the anarchists suggest, are often criminals, you know? So, I mean, the more you study power, and especially the abuses of power, the more you start to think that basically you cannot hold a senior, a top power position without committing at a certain point some crimes, you know? I mean, of course there are crimes and crimes, and that again is something which is quite interesting because, you know, Cameron and I are very much democratic, but there is something which the most competent, less corrupted parliament of the world is the House of Lords, which is non-elected. No. If you read all the discussions, the House of Lords about the Pinochet case, you really find an enormous amount of subtle arguments. He said, I mean, one of these lords said clearly, of course, if you are a head of state, you can commit some crimes, you know, and that, of course, you should accept it because it's the function of a head of state to commit some crimes. But if in these crimes you include torture, disappearance of persons, rape, you know, then you make a mockery of international law. And that was the reason why it was the majority vote, 3-2, in order to allow the continuation of the proceedings against Milosevic and the other. So it was a subtle argument, you know, subtle arguments. I mean, I don't know if you have seen The Darkest Hour, this film, Winston Churchill, you know, and sorry,
I'm going to follow up on Churchill.
No, it's okay. I mean, you really appreciate that the much celebrated Winston Churchill, you know, which saved us from Nazism, was himself a war criminal, you know. And so, but you know, that's outside the frame of the book.
Yeah,
you'll have the right to edit our.
Why?
Yeah, we always give people opportunity to
do edit Churchill?
No, edit our take of this lecture.
No, but that's fine. It's okay.
So, in light of Winston Churchill, and also in light of the recent death of Winnie Mandela, when you mentioned about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, is there any mechanism in international courts, aside from just TRCs, to differentiate why people commit crimes that may constitute war crimes, crimes against humanity? Does it matter why they do it, which side they're on? Is it only victor's justice, or are there potentialities for discriminating between cases based on what side you're on, what you fight for? Presumptively, Winston Churchill committing war crimes is bad, but not the same as the Nazis committing war crimes. Maybe it's not.
Yeah, well, I mean, thank you for that. That's very interesting. All the proceedings are generally informed by the liberal approach, you know, and therefore the individual psychological motivations which led any of these criminals to commit some crimes is not particularly taken into account. At least formally, but perhaps there are some cases in which it is happening. This has happened, for example, in Nuremberg. The fact that Albert Speer expressed some repentance for what has happened is perhaps one of the reasons why he was not hanged. And as you might know, he started to have a rather interesting conversation with Wiesenthal, and Wiesenthal at a certain point told him, if you would have known then what we know today about your personal involvement with Nazi atrocities, you would be hanged, you know? something similar has happened, for example, in the case of Yugoslavia. And that's another woman which was indicted and declared herself guilty and that she was sorry. And she got a lesser sentence than others. And when she was released after, I think, 9 years in jail, she said, no, I haven't repented at all, and so on, you know. But indeed, indeed, here somehow we should assess also the limits of the typical judicial instruments. If you take into account truth and reconciliation commissions, of course you have got a much wider battery of instruments, but perhaps the instruments are not precisely working as well at the tribunals. So my own impression is very simple. I mean, my idea is that the judicial devices should be used for the most important political responsibles of the crimes, you know, for the generals, the heads of states, the members of the government, and so on. For the others, it would be better to use other forms. And the case in which something similar has been attempted is the case in Rwanda. You know, the double combination of an international trial with a limited number of people indicted and a wider form of, you know, truth and reconciliation. Yeah?
Yeah, how about the issue of statute of limitations? Is there any statute of limitations? Like, can you go back and, for example, the application of church, actually church enforced the mass starvation came out in 1900. And actually, he didn't make one exception. Actually, he vetoed humanitarian aid, that was in 1942, but he made one exception for Greece, actually. Of course, that was after several hundred thousand Greeks died of starvation in 42. So starvation, of course, is a cause for a war crime, right? So, but is there a statute of limitation? Could somebody like sue England and say, well, you know, sue in terms of like state? I mean, church is dead, of course.
Yeah.
But the state can sue another state, or is there a statute of limitation?
Well, I mean, that, of course, that's the Second World War has gone as in terms of having, you know, anything to do. I mean, historians can do that, you know. Churchill was very good in order to write his own monumental history of the Second World War, and actually got even the literature Nobel Prize for it. That's something that we need to remember, you know. For good or for bad, they got even the literature Nobel Prize for history of the Second World War. In general terms, I think we should always take into account that there are different instruments. On the one hand, there are all the legal proceedings which regulate relations among states, you know? And therefore, the International Court of Justice would be the place where, if a state has a complaint against another state, they can discuss the issue there. And these are no personal responsibility. Is not the responsibility of states, which are no enforcement and so on, but still, I mean, is what the International Court of Justice is designed to do. When you speak about criminal, international criminal responsibility, then you somehow think that you need to target some individuals, you know? And therefore, you know, the two things are different. Now, we know very well that the International Court of Justice has some limitations that in order to deal with the case, it means that both states agree in order to bring the case in front of the court, unless there are some specific issues. For example, the majority of European countries would accept to be taken to court by any country which has accepted to be taken into court. You know, so if, for example, the case in between Italy and France, Italy has given for granted the possibility to go to the International Court of Justice. If there is a case between the United States and Italy, in that case, Italy reserves the right to decide if the country would like to go to court or not. You know? Then, of course, there are other cases for specific treaties, for example, treaties about navigation, about fishing, but it's an enormous amount. I mean, you know, international lawyers make a lot of money out of this sort of thing. So, But I mean, in terms of principles, we need to separate pretty well the principle of what is the collective responsibility of states, which goes in front of the International Court of Justice or similar institutions, from what is the individual responsibility for crimes, which go to the International Criminal Court or to other similar institutions.
So let me just follow up. I'm just curious, looking ahead, if there were a ruler that the, caused starvation for his own people, where would that, is there any appeal? I mean, who would bring the case for that sort?
Well, I mean, if it is against your own people, and if the state is a member of the International Criminal Court, the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court could open an investigation to see if this can be considered a case of genocide or a case of crime
against
humanity.
Against, minority.
Yes. If the state is a member of the court. Or if the state is not a member of the court, the Security Council can decide to refer the case to the International Criminal Court. You know, that's
very interesting. So, all right, let's go and have some treats and join me in thanking Professor.